Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Seeds of Liberty podcast. This is episode number 20. Danilo is off again this week, but we are joined by Mr. Lou Feen from the Freedom Feens radio show and podcast. Before we get started, just like to mention, as always, that the Seeds of Liberty podcast is covered by the BIPCOT no-gov license. This allows for reuse by anyone except for governments and the agents thereof. You can find more information about that at bipcot.org. All right, so Lou, thanks a lot for being on the show. Appreciate it.
Hey, thanks for having me. It's a real pleasure.
Like Dave said before we got on the show, you were you were the first person he thought of. So we're glad you accepted.
Oh wow! I'm working my way through the fiends.
Yes, yes.
Boopert's next. Boopert's my next target.
He's a hoot to talk to.
I love that guy.
He's a good guy. Before we really get into things, why don't, if you don't mind, Lou, why don't you tell our audience a little bit about yourself for those who may not, for some reason, be listening to the Feens as of yet and may not have heard of you or may not catch you on Facebook and all the wonderful things you put out there, as I mentioned before the show, that keep me laughing throughout the day. So,
while you're explaining that, could you also tell us why you hate the roads and the children and the poor so much? So just go ahead.
Well, I'm Lou. I'm one of the co-hosts, one of the, like, I don't know, 673 co-hosts on the Freedom Feens radio show. It is broadcast or syndicated through Genesis Communications Network. It's on probably somewhere around 34, 35 terrestrial radio stations across the country, not to mention it's also streamed on Liberty Radio Network, a couple other online streaming things, a couple pirate stations, pirate radio stations. So, yeah, it's all over the place. Freedomfiends.com. Go there and get your inoculation from indoctrination. So, yeah. And I hail from the failed state project, the Metro Detroit area. And I got out of the blast radius a few months ago and moved up to the Upper Peninsula of Michigan. So I'm in a little area called Bear Saskatchewan. It's part of the New World Order merger with Canada. And yeah, it's...
Is that where Tim Taylor lives?
I don't know. Who's Tim Taylor? You talk about Tim Allen?
Yeah, I think that's what he was referring to.
Yeah, from Home Improvement. Sorry.
Oh.
No, I think he was supposed to be a Detroit... He was supposed to be a Detroit guy, I think.
Okay, all right.
I think that was the whole point. I don't remember. I barely remember.
I'm really not that far away from Escanaba, and if you guys are fans of Jeff Daniels, he had that little thing, Escanaba in the Moonlight, which I've never seen, by the way. But when I was living down the Failed State Project area... he had a theater out in Chelsea, Michigan, which was not too far from the People's Republic of Ann Arbor. I don't know, probably about 20 minutes away from there. And I think it was like the Purple Rose Theater or something like that. I can't remember exactly. But so he was a native guy and did a lot in the area. So, yeah, never met him, cool. though. Oh.
All right. So if I guess we can get started with Lou actually came up with some great topics that I think we should have a lot of fun with. the first one, which I'm actually interested in hearing your perspective on this, was that Ron Paul didn't actually bring liberty to the people. Because so many people claim that Ron Paul got them, you know, may have got them here, or he did all these wonderful things, and he was the one good guy in there. But he still is a statist after all. So,
quick question: did you read that properly, or was that a Freudian slip? Because you said Ron.
Did
Paul
I say right?
You said Ron Paul did not bring liberty to the people. That goes without saying. You could tell that just by looking, you know, around at the world and seeing what's going on. You don't have to be a rocket scientist for that. What I should have said, and
I apologize.
Well, sometimes I get a little dyslexic.
Ron Paul did not bring people to liberty.
Oh, people to liberty. Oh, okay, that's even okay. That goes.
And I'm guessing the message of liberty.
Well, no matter how you slice it, the statement is correct. So he didn't bring liberty to people, and he didn't bring people to liberty. And this is actually one of Ben Stone, the Bad Quakers, things. With Ron Paul, if you say that Ron Paul brought people to liberty, okay, what you're actually saying is they were too stupid to recognize that there was a problem in the first place, and had Ron not said, hey, there's a problem, they would still be waving the government's flag and saying, it's McCain's turn. And what Ben's idea is that Barack Obama, George W. Bush, Bill Clinton, Papa Bush, and, you know, just all the tyrants going down the line actually created the demand for the liberty movement by increasing the tyranny. If you look at Ron Paul and his roughly 30 years in Congress, okay, he didn't do a solid 30 years or some time off for good behavior in there. but he was largely ignored back in the 70s. Well, dare I say completely ignored. You know, outside of his district, nobody cared about him, nobody knew anything about him, whatever. Through the 80s, still ignored. Through the 90s, still ignored. Mm-hmm. But you get into around 2008, and, well, I think the campaign started in probably 2006 and you know, really got going in 2007. In 2007 is when the market started to decline. I believe it was either 24 or 26% was lost from, I think it was September 2007 through September of 2008. So that was the S&P. It had either 26 or 24. The month of September, or maybe it was October.
That's child's play considering what's coming.
Yeah. Well, the month of October 2008 was the other number. So if if the whole year of 2007, so I think it was October 2007 to the end of September or October of 2008, that lost 26%. But the month of October 2008 alone, there was a 24% hit. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So you're looking at roughly a 50% drop in the stock market, and that was really my eye opener to, you know, what's going on with the economy. Is capitalism, you know, inherently flawed, you know, destined to fail, and do we need, you know, the wise overlords of, you know, mommy and daddy of government to come in and discipline those greedy capitalists and get them to share their toys with everybody else, and, you know, just all that other nonsense that you get in the government indoctrination camps. So, but I was still a neocon at the time, so I wasn't really, you know, I was ignoring Ron Paul, and as I was saying, it was John McCain's turn. Being the neocon status that I was in 2008, McCain was my choice, but George W. Bush out-Jesused him, and everybody says, oh my God, he's a good Christian, I'm going to vote for him. Never mind the fact that he can't put six words together in a sentence. So...
What? Now, hold on. In 2008, George Bush had already...
Or I'm sorry, 2000. Oh, 2000.
Okay.
Yeah, because McCain went up against him in 2000. And in McCain's defense, I think he was a little bit less rabid at the time. He had a little bit... The rabies hadn't set in, or the encephalitis, whatever it was that rotted his brain out. But
well,
anyway.
You got to understand, like...
Well, he went to talk...
Outside of backroom, shady, fucking fascistic bullshit... ordeals, John McCain's probably as smart as a rock.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, he's a pretty dumb fella.
Oh yeah, he's dumber than six bags of buttholes now.
Most of them. I was gonna say, well, yeah, when he ran against Bush the first time, he was just, you know, the supposed war hero. He didn't get crazy until after 9/11, and then he just and then him and all his war hawk buddies that, you know, ratcheted up the crazy to you know, DEFCON 9 million. And
yeah, I lump him in that Mitch McConnell, Lindsey Graham category of, like, people that if they all died in a bus crash, I think that we could all be happy.
Well, until somebody says we have to get back to the Constitution and rebuild it. But anyway, let me get back to my original rant or rambling or whatever you want to call it. So anyway, yeah, I knew something was wrong, and, you know, I bought a couple of, like, I don't know, I guess mainstream books, whatever, on economics and finance, things like that. But it was later on that I was watching Tom Woods on the Glen Beck Show. And Tom was talking about the Forgotten Depression of 1920 and 21. So I'm like, hey, I never heard about this in school. Why didn't they teach this? You know, because I heard that the New Deal brought us out. And then when I started listening to Rush Limbaugh, I found out that it was World War II. And now I got this guy here that's explaining this stuff. And it turns out that they're all full of shit. But anyway, so because I had an interest in economics, I went to Tom Woods' website. Well, first I Googled that particular article, the topic. And then I went to his website and I'm looking and checking stuff out. And I found couple of his lectures on YouTube were linked in there in the article, so I'm like, okay. And by the way, that was my first time using YouTube. So anyway, I'm going through all these different articles on TomWoods.com, and then I, you know, started going over. I'm looking at stuff at Lou Rockwell and, you know, stuff at the Mises Institute, and I wind up getting this big giant crash course in economics, and I realized that they're all full of shit. They're all Keynesians. But anyway, so. If you look at the increase in tyranny, if you look at more and more laws, if you look at the financial crisis, you know, being directed by government economic policy and central banking and things like this, you know that there's something wrong, and you kind of have a grip on what it is. Ron Paul, he carried the same message for all those years and nobody listened to him in the beginning. And then when things got bad enough, that's when they started paying attention. And it's just like somebody who has a substance abuse problem. If they are a heroin addict or a crack addict, whatever, when they're doing lines off of a stripper's butt, they're not too worried about it. But when they wake up with a tranny hooker shooting Krokodil, you know, that's when they start thinking that rehab is the place to go. So... the heroin addict of America, of, you know, Bubus Americanus, homo-parisitis, whatever you want to call them, they realize there's a problem. Well, not enough of them do, but...
Well, they think government's going to fix this problem.
Right, right.
And
right.
It's impossible at this point. $200 trillion in debt, you're done for.
Right. But what it really comes down to is, you know, people are recognizing that there's a problem, and yeah, you could have listened to Ron Paul and he could talk about, you know, going and reading, you know, Human Action or reading the Constitution. After you read the Constitution, you turn into an anarchist because you realize that the Constitution isn't that good. And if most of the Constitution humpers would read it for a first time, they probably wouldn't be Constitution humpers anymore. But
yeah, that used to be one of my favorite things to ask people that, like, when I'd go to Tea Party meetings and stuff, I'd be like, hey, so what, you know, what's your favorite part of the Constitution? Oh, and it's pretty much always the Bill of Rights. Like, they think that's like 99% of the Constitution.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, I get a kick out of the guys from Campaign for a Tiny Bit More Liberty.
Hell yeah.
Which, by the way, they were the inspiration for Campaign for a Longer Leash, Facebook page. So anyway, this one guy was talking about, you know, state nullification, how great it was, and his example was he cited that people in Wisconsin, the state of Wisconsin, nullified the Fugitive Slave Act of 1850, and he talked about how, you know, when something unconstitutional like the Fugitive Slave Act of 1850 is put into law, the states have the power to nullify it. But because this dumb shit never read the Constitution, he has no idea that the Fugitive Slave Laws originated in Article 4, Section 2, Clause 3 of the stupid-ass Constitution and were followed with the Fugitive Slave Act of 1793, something else he didn't know about. But state nullification is the answer to nullify the Constitution.
Yeah. Well, nullification is a dirty word in most people's mind. I mean, it's finally now starting to gain some more traction, thankfully, but it goes right up there with the secession. Everybody thinks it's this horrible word because it's been demonized. Even if you want to believe that the founders really had good intentions, and, you know, I think most of us can agree, most of them probably didn't. But for those people out there that still believe that, you know, even if you want to believe that, they, you know, people that most of these guys revere, you know, like Jefferson and Madison. I mean, hell, they wrote the what was it, the resolutions of 1798 and 1799, which talked about nullification, how it mm-hmm. was, you know, the rightful remedy to, you know, I think that was actually the line from Jefferson. It's the rightful, you know, that is the rightful remedy to any action by the government. But again, as you said, it doesn't matter because it was the problem that needed to be fixed was created by the system in the first place.
Exactly. Exactly. And I really enjoyed the episode where you had Prof CJ on. I'm a big fan of his.
Yes.
I think you're the one who got me into the show.
Okay, yeah, probably.
Yeah, I heard you guys talking about on the Feens, and that was the first I had heard of it. I started listening because of that, so we were very happy when he agreed to come on too, because I'm trying to find time to catch up on all his old stuff, because I didn't jump in until just I
caught up. Well, I've got like 2 American Revolution episodes left, but
well, that's where I started, the very first American Revolution one. He had just put it out, and I was like, this is awesome, because it's my favorite subject, because I love beating down conservatives and Tea Partiers with knowledge of their sacred document that, as you were saying, they don't even know.
Yeah, I have caught every single episode of his. Most of them I have listened to more than once. Mm-hmm. So
I have too many podcasts to listen to. If I don't get it on the first run, it's over.
I could see that, though. He puts so much information into a relatively short amount of time, and I'm sure I could probably learn even more if I listen a second time around. Mm-hmm. But I suffer from the same thing Dave does. I listen to way too much stuff because of my business, I spend 6 to 10 hours a day walking and or driving in my car by myself or with my dog. So I have lots of time to listen to stuff. So I just try to cram as much as I can in, and gets on overload. And sometimes I forget things. So I should go back and listen again.
Well, if you're only able to listen to each episode one time because you have, you know, multiple podcasts to listen to, you have too many podcasts on your list. You're going to have to get rid of something.
Yes, you're absolutely right. I need to cut. I started to cut down.
But anyway, yeah, that's like my new bad Quaker. And what's really nice in there, and I say bad Quaker because back when Ben had his podcast, I was a devoted listener for the same reasons that I listen to Prof. CJ. And incidentally, I heard about Prof. CJ through the interview that Ben did with him. Mm. But anyway, yeah, when you look at history, and you know, you take the Fondling Fathers, for example, Madison, I don't know what his deal was. You got Hamilton, who is just like, you know, this big giant centralizer. He's like a Donald Trump, mm-hmm. or you know, Teddy Roosevelt. I even put this question to CJ. I says, hey, who do you think was the real boss in this? Do you think Hamilton was Washington's lackey, or do you think Hamilton was the power behind the throne, sticking his hand up Washington's ass?
No, Washington was the puppet with the he was the figurehead that they could use to play everybody's emotions with. And Jackson and pretty much Adams and all those guys were the real moving into the real politicians. You could see, mm-hmm. I mean, well, Washington's policies outside of the big. Whiskey rebellion thing. Outside of that, it was pretty. I don't know what the fuck I'm doing-ish. And
I personally think that Hamilton was manipulating him quite a bit. I think Hamilton got involved in politics specifically with the purpose of looting and pillaging. Mm-hmm. I think Adams. I'm not as knowledgeable on these guys as some people would be, but I personally think that Adams was really that delusional, naive, and such a filthy bootlicking statist. When you look at how he believes that the destiny of a country is based solely on their magic piece of parchment, what kind of nonsense is that? What kind of parchment worship is that?
So yeah, it's pretty amazing.
I would have to agree with what you said, Lou, because I mean ever since because of people like Prof. CJ and other. What they call revisionist historians, but you know, are really just telling the actual story that we were, you know, never let, you know, even Tom Woods got, I was actually my, you know, you were saying that he was my in too. It's funny that you mentioned that. I just happened to catch an interview of him somewhere. And I'm one of the people who actually had pretty much no contact or interest in Ron Paul other than meeting him once, because my friends here on Long Island who are all huge fans of him went to a book signing and they took me with them, and I was like, all right. So I met the man, shook his hand, but other than that, he wasn't my in at all. Tom Woods actually was. Yeah. But Hamilton,
that's exactly the case.
Yeah,
for me.
But But from all those, from people like that, that I've, you know, that I've gone back and that was my in altogether was history. That's how I started studying all this stuff and then realizing the mistakes and the contradictions. But Hamilton, from everything I've been able to gather, was definitely the one. I mean, if, from what I know, he was, you know, he was only like 16 or something when he became, when he supposedly became Washington's lackey at the beginning of the whole war in the first place.
I think it was around 20.
Okay, was I thought he was even younger than that when he first got hooked up with him. But either way, I mean, he was still young, and he was an admitted monarchist. He literally just wanted to replace one King George with another King George. That
but
was his goal.
You got to understand, his idea was that government is good and leadership is good as long as the leadership is virtuous. And that's the lie he sold to the other people, you know, Patrick Henry, all the other people that didn't want a constitution, didn't want a federal government. That was a lie. He said, this system is going to make sure that only virtuous people get in. And well, we see George Washington is not a very virtuous person. He was the first person elected. So, maybe.
Are you talking about Adams or Hamilton?
Hamilton.
Yeah. Okay. Adams was the one that says that our constitution is only fit for a moral people and all this other stuff. Mm-hmm.
Hamilton,
well, it was really Federalists.
Hamilton hid behind the flowery language he put out in the Federalist Papers, him and John Jay and Madison. And it was really Madison and Jay that were not. It was Hamilton and Jay that were the really they were the hardcore Federalists. Like Madison wavered. If you actually read, I have one of the collections of a lot of his works and stuff. When I was a constitutionalist and I was still blinded, I bought a bunch of those books, so I read a lot of his stuff. And he kind of like flip-flopped throughout his career where, he wrote something like the resolution of 1799, the Virginia one, or he wrote the 1798 one. And then he wrote the report of 1800. And then later on in his career, he was saying that secession and nullification were actually wrong and he had been wrong the whole time. It's like, no. that was the only remedy anybody had. I mean, I still promote secession as much as possible on the individual level. I insist everybody, I suggest that everybody who wants to be free just secede from the Union. But yeah, Hamilton was definitely pulling Washington's strings. I mean, I've read stuff on Washington where he admittedly he admitted he was not a very smart man. Like compared to the other guys, he considered himself a complete idiot. Yeah. Compared to the well-read people like
well, he was
Jefferson
so rich. He was one of the richest people in the country. So
well, yeah, he had family money, and then he stole a lot more.
So so is it your idea is like that? Is Ron Paul has kind of been pushed up and shoved up as this kind of demagogue or something like?
Yeah, he is a man, not a god.
Oh, for sure. Like,
Well, go. Post an anti-Ron Paul Facebook post or Twitter post and see just how many libertarians, anarchists, just absolutely get their jimmies rustled and get all butthurt on you.
I mean, as far as I'm concerned, Ron Paul is probably my second favorite minarchist of all time. So, I mean...
Who's your first?
Thoreau.
Okay, and as far as government thugs go, Ron Paul is my all-time favorite government thug, and that's what he was because he was part of the government.
Thoreau said some stuff that,
Thoreau was never a government thug, was he?
No, he wasn't. But no, he went to jail multiple times for not paying taxes. But he said that, all right. So like the fascist sees the state, individuals here, right? Mm-hmm. And the state has more rights than the individual. Thoreau's idea was you have the state here and the individual here, and the individual only is subservient to the state if he consents to it. So it's almost like he was a panarchist, if you're familiar with that term. So yeah. I really like what he has to say a lot, but he's definitely a minarchist, definitely.
Well, I mean, I guess I get to see that because, I mean, like I said, I mentioned, I had no connection to Ron Paul and I still found this. But I guess it's funny. You're right, though. A lot of people will take some serious butthurt over that. But yeah. It's curious. I mean, that would be my question, though. Like, what about all those, I guess, to what you originally asked, like, the claim you're making about, Ron Paul not actually... leading people to
I think
liberty.
He was for some people
well, yeah,
but not
there
for
are, there are people that
not
really
as this great
that.
Savior. I mean, he wasn't libertarian Jesus.
Well, the thing is, he carried the message, all right? Mm-hmm. And Jeremy, you and I, our path was Tom Woods, mm-hmm. okay? Tom Woods carried the message. I think Tom Woods is a much better speaker. I think he's probably a lot smarter than Ron. At least he presents himself that way.
Tom drives me nuts because he has certain contradictions that he refuses to let go of.
Like what? I'm not that familiar.
I mean, he just has some stuff about what would truly happen in a voluntary society, and he's like, sometimes he said, like, you know, like the other day he did a podcast where it was, the whole discussion was Rand Paul and that he would be helping Rand Paul's campaign and stuff. I'm like, well, I mean, I know you can do with your body what you want, but you can't demean and destroy and obfuscate a system and then want to be part of it.
Okay. Yeah,
I don't know about that.
Which leads to our second question, or thing that Lou wanted to talk about.
Oh yeah, I guess we could get into that if we were done with the Ron Paul beating.
Well, I'm probably not going to finish the Ron Paul stuff until the end of the show. That's how we'll know that the show's over.
There you go.
don't even set a timer. It's when I finally finish the Ron Paul story.
And so, I think when a fiend goes on a rant, it's a fant. I was thinking about that earlier.
Oh, I don't know. It could be. But anyway, yes. So. But, Ron Paul carried a message, and that's all he did. I don't think a whole lot of his ideas were really original or anything like that. You know, and he didn't tell people go out and be anarchists. You know, they figured that out once they read the Constitution. So, I mean, it's the whole thing about Ron Paul is people have a tendency to make a great man out of somebody. And I'm not going to go through Ben's great man, whole great man list. I'm going to summarize as quickly as possible. There's this notion that every once in a generation or so that some special person with special knowledge, wisdom, powers, capabilities comes along and does what no other human being can do. And, you know, Herbert Spencer absolutely destroyed that theory, you know, back in, I think it was early 1800s. But
that's a Robert Anton Wilson theory as well.
Okay, well, he's wrong too. But
no, he says the amount of, you know, like there was one Jesus 2,000 years ago, mm-hmm. and then like five, you know, every halfening of that, it doubles. So like 1,000 years after that, you had all these other people bringing new ideas and changing the way people see the whole world, you know, 500 years after that, and it's a multiplicity. It's almost like the singularity thing that, you know.
Okay, all right.
So like, and he measures them in Jesus's. So he's like, you know, in 1950 we may have had 2,000 Jesus's in the world.
We should be overrun with Jesus's at this point if that theory was true.
Well, think Trump keeps complaining about all those Jesus's coming out of Mexico.
Yeah.
But
so who's your favorite minarchist? Was it, you said Pat Buchanan?
You know what? There are some things I like about Pat Buchanan. But other stuff I can't handle. I mean, it's,
well, you know, weed is really bad for your brain. Like, it destroys kids' minds.
I think he must have smoked his fair amount, because on some things he's just poo-pooed. Yeah. Now, I can't really say that I have a favorite mini statist. It would probably be Ron Paul. Yeah, my favorite mini statist / government thug.
I don't call minarchist. I mean, I do because you guys know what it means. But like, to them, I call them limited communist, like, because they support a limited form of communism.
Limited liberty.
Yes.
Or just longer leash advocates.
Campaign for a longer leash. I saw that the first time I saw that, I laughed for hours. I just would chuckle.
Oh, that thing picked up really heavy. Oh, and by the way, the real brains behind that, or the person who's taking the reins of it, is Neema Vedadi's mom, Lisa.
Oh, nice.
Neema Vedadi. I like that guy.
Yeah. Yeah, his mom was commenting on there, and you know, she's posting her little meme responses, and I'm like, hey, why don't you join the team? And I added her to it, and she's probably the majority of the content that you see.
Wow.
we still get some fan submissions and everything, but she posts something just about every day. She keeps that thing alive. If it were just left up to me and the other guys, it would have page faded a long time ago. So, you know, yeah, kudos to you, Lisa. You're awesome.
That's awesome that his mom is that. I can only dream of having my mom anywhere. I've only now got her to start to admit that she may have been paid with not so honest funds her most of her life because she was a public school teacher. I'm only starting to get her to come around on that. So,
okay, so she has a vested interest in continuing the lie, and a lot of people do. But anyway, going back to Prof CJ, God damn it, I'm going to get one solid thought out in one little rant if it kills me. Going back to Prof CJ, you start hearing about all these different things, and ultimately, like with the Constitution, if you look at the implementation of federal taxation, the assumption of the state war debt, and the fact that the lawyers, guns, and money that were at the 1787 coup, a lot of them had gone out and speculated and bought those Revolutionary War bonds for pennies on the dollar. Mm-hmm. And now they're going to get full payment on it. I mean, that's the first bankster bailout.
Mm. Yep.
In U.S. history. So if you go to some hardcore Constitution humper who believes that Hamilton is this great guy and that the Constitution was a good thing because you need the central power to keep the states from separate states from going to war with each other so that you can settle disputes amongst the states and so that you can ensure that there's free trade amongst the several states. Oh, by the way, that's the same argument for world government, the United Nations, New World Order, whatever you want to call it. So Constitution lickers should absolutely love the New World Order and embrace it. But, if you look at a lot of these problems of what goes on, the bickering between the states, it's not the people that are bickering with each other, it's the governments that are bickering. Yeah. Or it's the governments that are bickering on behalf of certain moneyed interests. So when you have, all this nonsense going on, these petty differences between these little, state governments, which were technically national governments at the time, and then you say, oh, well, the only way to solve this is to have a bigger, more centralized government to come in and referee and ensure fair play. Let's come up with this constitution. Okay, so at what point is world government not a good thing, using that line of thinking? And mm-hmm. You say that to some of these guys, and all of a sudden their head is blown. It's like, oh my God, you're crazy. What are you, some kind of communist? Move to Somalia. So argumentum ad Somalium to and it's
that was my post today. I don't know if you saw.
Nah, I was at work and I didn't see
it. I think you liked it. Maybe
I could have.
Yeah. Sometimes I just go on a liking spree. But this is another thing I tell constitutionalists that would lay down their life for the Constitution that they probably never read or even understand, is like, out of the 21 men that signed the Constitution, 14 of them owned slaves. What does a slave owner know about freedom?
Well, even better, why would a slave owner say, is life so dear, peace so sweet, as to be purchased at the price of chains and slavery? Gee, you think maybe he knew slavery was bad?
Yeah. Yeah.
But hey, that was another time. That they were a product of their generation. I'm gonna laugh my ass off if I'm still alive when they get to a point where people defending Hitler would say, well, it was another time. They didn't know that burning Jews was bad.
Mm-hmm.
You never want to burn Jews.
Yeah. Or gypsies.
Yes. Well, yeah. You could easily see that coming because you're right. That's a wonderful trend in the status paradigm. It's always it's the complete stripping of any semblance of moral agency from the individual. It's just that's how things were. That's they didn't know any better. It's like, you really why? Because they didn't have the right piece of paper to tell them what was better. I mean, that's that's what it comes down to. Because
the abolitionist movement started in the 1600s with the Quakers. I'm sure they might have heard something about it.
Yeah.
Especially since the Quakers were pretty heavy in the Pennsylvania area, I believe. Mm-hmm. Always bitching and complaining about slavery. But
yes.
Anyway, so they choose to ignore it. We take a look at the Constitution, and having read the whole thing and seeing, that like Articles 1 through 7 are the things that we are expected to endure and take it, and Amendments 1 through 10 would be completely unnecessary if not for Articles 1 through 7. Mm-hmm. And, we don't think that government is such a good thing. And rather than going with the well, if only the right people were in charge, or if only, you know, the plan was followed. And incidentally, that's what the defenders of state socialism in the former USSR, East Germany, and all these other places say, you know, when asked, well, why did it fail? Well, if only the right people were in charge. Mm-hmm. You know, the plan mm-hmm. wasn't followed properly. So
communism fails because politicians are always going to be looking out for themselves. Limited communism, or minarchy, it fails because...
MinStatism.
Mensria fails as well because of people are out for their own. Like, you give an entity the power to have a monopoly over national defense, they're going to give all that tax money to buddies of theirs that help prop them up.
Yeah, I mean, people had this idea that the government has gone bad, and it hasn't. Government has gone government. It, you know, with the example that you just gave of, you know, okay, we're going to have a national defense. Well, who's going to get the contracts to make the, you know, make the stuff? And you could go full state socialism and have government operated factories, or you can, you know, embrace the creativity of the private sector and have the crony capitalism, fascism going on. And, you know, that way you can say, well, we're not completely socialist. We're only sort of socialist. You know, never mind the fact that the state owns the military, directs the military, centrally plans and controls how it works, and everybody's forced to pay for it. Some pay more, some pay less, but hey, from each according to his ability to each according to his need.
Absolutely.
So, yeah. I mean, when we look at it, you know, the three of us here and probably most of your listeners, they're going to say, well, yeah, I mean, there's no way that it could wind up any different. You know, I mean, it could vary in degree. It could be a little bit better. It could be a little bit worse. I mean, it could have wound up like North Korea. You know, I mean, who knows? But
there's still time.
Yeah. Oh, trust me. Trust me.
What's scarier is the United States government is way more well funded than the Korean government.
Yeah. But the thing is, I mean, when somebody like us, a small L libertarian, a anarchist, a voluntarist, an abolitionist, a don't label me bro, I ain't got time for that shit. when somebody says, or just a good old no gov guy, you know, people, you know, BIPCOT people,
a cisgendered white male, gotcha.
Yeah. I'm not up on all the SJW stuff.
Yeah, just don't worry about it.
But I have been bashing the GJWs quite a bit. That's government justice warriors. You know, support the police state. But anyway.
Oh yeah, those people exist, and it is the Kool-Aid is real. It's like they're at night they plug the IV of Kool-Aid in, like they fall asleep to Fox News.
We don't see government as being a good thing. The degree of how bad it's going to be, you know, that can change, but ultimately it's not a good thing because, one, it is monopolistic. It is all government socialist in nature.
But monopolies aren't bad, and that's a big thing that anti-capitalists need to understand. Monopolies aren't bad. Forced monopolies back to with the power of a gun, those are bad. That's truly evil. That's, you know.
Yeah, but... really, the only time in history that there's ever been a natural monopoly would be when a brand new industry popped up and there was only one actor in the market.
Yeah, but that only lasts for a certain amount of time.
Yeah, not very long at all, because once it's determined that it's profitable, other people get in on it. But the thing is, with government always being monopolistic, it's always socialist in nature. It, you know, central planning, central control, and, you know, just all the crap that goes along with government, we don't see it as being good. There's no way that it can ever be good. It can suck a little bit less, or it can suck a little bit more, but it can never be a good, honest, legitimate social arrangement. It's the piss poor way to order a society, and society is separate from government, contrary to what all these socialistic bootlicking statists say.
God, and, yes.
And I seriously, I'm getting tired of complaining about these Republicans. But
Well, it's hard not to. They give you so much fodder.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Oh, I don't know what it is. I don't know what's worse. See, like, hard left-wing Democrats, they're just blindly stupid, right? They don't really, they're just like, you know, my feels. And the right-wing conservatives is, I know everything. You're wrong. Move to Somalia. Blah, blah, blah. Fascism. Like, I just don't get it. Like, how they don't, they're so blinded they don't see that, like, what they support is these things.
Well, and we're going to hit that a little bit later on with the whole idea that there's very little difference from the American conservative and the Soviet communist hardliner. But I guess what we're really leading into right now would be, I guess, the second thing to talk about, and that is how libertarian political action is actually Keynesian in nature. And the thesis behind this, and I've really just been working on this, this just popped into my head a couple of days ago. But when you look at people that are getting involved in politics, the folks are saying, well, I'm going to get involved and I'm going to change it from the inside. You know, like Ron Paul tried to do. But
spend a lifetime, accomplish nothing.
Yeah. So how is this Keynesian in nature? If you look at a recession by the Austrian School of Economics, Austrian Business Cycle Theory, and I'm really going to paraphrase the living hell out of this. A recession is not a bad thing. A recession is when the economy is cleansing itself of malinvestment. You take, for example, the housing boom. A lot more money went into housing than should have. And the way that it was able to was through, one, artificially low interest rates set by the central bank, two, increasing the money supply, which is a major factor. One and two are probably the biggest factors in it. But by having all this extra money created and available to get thrown down this rat hole of the housing sector, that's what fuels the boom.
And you're forgetting one third and major component in the subprime lending thing, the laws that
I was going to get to that.
Yeah, okay, my bad.
Yeah. So yeah, number three being the lending requirements, and there's an article. It was posted by the Boston Fed. I think they've taken down their version of it, but there's another version. It's called Boston Fed Closing the Gap. And what that does is it talks about how banks are expected to make loans to risky people, meaning people that don't have a credit history, but in the name of egalitarianism, meaning that minorities can lose their home just as much as white people can, they need to have these loans given to them. So they talk about, you know, okay, this is what we'd like you to do. And by the way, here's the punishment if you don't do it for the first offense, boom, boom, boom. So, yeah, and those are three major parts, and you could probably go a lot further, and we don't have time to go into all that stuff. But anyway, had it not been for maybe take one or two of those things out of the equation, maybe you don't have the housing boom and bust, okay? Or maybe it's nowhere near as bad. But if it had just been like a simple recession, some building companies would have gone out of business, some construction companies, maybe a real estate company, probably a couple of the big lenders would go out of business. And although it's bad to, see people lose their jobs and nobody wants to see a company go under, sometimes it just has to fucking happen. And what that is it's cleansing the malinvestment out of the system. Now, if a big bank goes belly up, okay. Well, it's not like those homes are going to, disappear into thin air like the money created to put them up. And they're not going to go away. There's going to be companies out there that are going to go and they're going to buy these bad mortgages. They're going to buy them at a discount, and they're going to contact the lendees, the borrowers, and they're going to say, "Hey, we just bought your loan. We saw that you're not paying it back at the full price. Since we, bought it for 30 cents on the dollar, we're willing to rewrite it to at 40 cents on the dollar for you." And, everybody wins. And the people that made stupid decisions go belly up. Okay.
Yep. So, but you're not looking at it through the fascist size, man. If I own a big bank, I'm going to want the government to bail me out.
Right. Well, I'm getting to that. I'm going by Austrian business theory of how things should work. So,
Our listener base isn't that smart, okay? I'm kidding. They're pretty intelligent.
It's just over Dave's head. Keep going, Lou. It's fine.
Hey, don't rag on your listener base. Those three guys are real nice.
Exactly. Gonna have them over for a beer next week.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I tell you what. When I do every show, I dedicate it to my fan. But so anyway, yeah. That's how it works in the real world, and nobody loses their life. Nobody really suffers too bad because it doesn't happen on such a large scale. Now, when you go with Keynesianism, you have people that say, oh my God, we have to pump stimulus money into this sector. So rather than having the bubble burst and, people going back to their corners, washing up and getting ready to go back out in the market, you have a continuation of the problem. So rather than having the bubble burst and the stupid lending company going out of business, and the people who made big giant houses going out of business, rather than having that happen so that the market can actually reset, you have the continuation of all these houses being built where there's nobody to buy them or people can't afford them. You have people getting loans that can't afford to repay them, but in the name of equality, in feels and fuzzies, you have these same lending policies and the same thing's going to happen again. So a recession is when government intervention throws the economy off, and a depression is when government intervention tries to fix it. Yes. So what it actually does is it prolongs the life of the recession, turning it into a depression. And it keeps the same idiots in place where they should be unemployed. And eventually the collapse, when it goes from, full-blown depression to just absolute, Sharknado fuck shit, and, it makes it a whole lot worse. So it's kind of like getting the chicken pox as a kid versus getting it as an adult. You get it as a kid, maybe you got to put some socks on your hands and duct tape them around your wrist so you don't scratch yourself to death. But if you're in your 30s and get the chicken pox, you can die from that.
Yeah.
So making the bubble even bigger is going to create more damage down the road. Mm-hmm. So let's talk about libertarian political activism being Keynesian in nature. One, rather than letting the government collapse like it should, rather than letting it go out of business, what you are doing is you are stimulating interest in the government by going out and, let's say you lobby for something. Let's say you're one of those people that lobbied for legalization of marijuana in Colorado, okay? What you see is people not getting arrested for prohibition. So you see that there's actually freedom there. What you don't see is that, one, they didn't get rid of any cops, because now instead of enforcing prohibition, they're enforcing regulation. So you still have the same number of tax eater cops on there. Oh, and incidentally, by taxing cannabis, you have now taken more money out of the productive economy and thrown it into the rat hole of government, which is going to be used for enforcement of regulation, probably some enforcement of prohibition, because you're not free unless you have your licenses and permits. And
also, a lot of that tax money is going to Colorado's public schools.
Right, the indoctrination camp. Where they teach you to, pledge allegiance to the flag and who says there's not prayer in school anymore? But so anyway, you got that going on. And now the SWAT teams, they're still doing raids, but now they're carrying clipboards to go along with all their heavy weaponry. So is there a real net gain for liberty out of cannabis being legalized in Colorado?
No. Minute. Minute amount, but not like, holy shit, dancing out in the field of wheat,
Yeah, wow. You do see some gains because people aren't getting thrown in jail for possession unless it's untaxed.
Yeah, but net is a negative, I would say, because the other stuff you just described.
Well, I have a few friends that live in Colorado, and what they tell me is only tourists are buying at the pot shops.
Sounds about right.
All the people that live there either grow their own or still buy it from their weed man who is getting it grown or whatnot. So it's half the price and no taxes. So
yeah, but how much?
Any regulation always creates a black market.
Yeah. But how much did they rake in last year? What were they touting? Like 100 million, 200 million, 50, something like that?
50 million, actually.
No, I think it was more than that. And that's all, as Lou said, that's just money going right to the government coffers to be wasted on other crap. So
yeah.
In the end, it's actually worse. And the idiots that are paying, what is it, 30%+ the tax rate they have on that stuff? It's insane. Yeah.
So if you're a small government, limited government, unicorn-chasing Libertarian Party person, or a... many states Republican. Congratulations on putting more money into the government coffers. Way to grow government while shrinking government. So you got, let's say, people are really focusing on, the fact that they're allowed to get permission to smoke cannabis in Colorado. How many other laws have been passed during that time?
Yeah, I have
quite a few. Yeah, a lot.
Yeah. How many really bad laws?
A lot.
Okay.
You'd have to guess.
So at the end of the...
No one's taking laws off the books at this point. They're only adding more.
Right. So at the end of the year, when you're doing your accounting, instead of doing your taxes, you're going to count how many new taxes have been added. You're going to count how many new laws have been added. So is liberty in the red or is it in the black at the end of the year? Is there more liberty than when you started the fiscal year or the calendar year?
I mean, I can get high
absolutely
and eat
less.
Cheetos. Oh, wait, what?
Oh, there's absolutely less at the end of the year.
Yeah. Yeah. Ultimately, when you factor in everything, you have less liberty. You have a little bit more, you have a tiny bit more liberty in one particular area, but overall, you have less liberty. So,
well statists, especially of the socialist variety that plague Colorado, they don't see economic freedom as like physical individual freedom as well, whereas ANCAPs, voluntarists, whatever, we know that economic freedom is just as quintessential as individual I can do with my body what I want freedom.
Well of course, because you said they're socialists, so they don't understand economics.
Right, because they went to government schools, which are getting more money from cannabis sales. But anyway.
It's for the children, Lou. That's what it's all about. That's what they sold
it
as.
Mom and dad have to go to work, so those, they got to pay taxes. So
no,
we need daycare centers for them.
It's definitely a negative on the whole, but what you said is they don't see it. They don't see it because most people, even the well-intentioned ones, they have their own one or two pet projects or whatever it is, and they
single issue voters essentially.
Yeah, even if they have a couple, that's all they focus on. So if something positive happens in that arena, it's that much easier for them to overlook all the other negative stuff or not even pay attention to the negative stuff, because they're just like, well, I got my victory, so that it's good for it's good for me. And it helps perpetuate the cycle, because
I guess you can smoke a joint while a boot is on your neck. I mean, that is a positive.
You might
cough a little bit more.
Yeah, I like to carry one in my pocket just for that occasion, because I will do so when that finally occurs.
A boot or a joint?
I'm saying I carry a boot. No, I carry the joint with me.
when he says stay to those dogs, he fucking means it. Okay.
Yes. Damn, Skippy.
I get your whole thesis here that any endeavor into politics to try to fix it, if it does, and this is kind of what I told to one of the guys that came on the show and was talking about the LP, and I was like, if the LP does succeed, it only shows that the system works, and I said that in quotation, because if you make a bad system, a system based off of theft, better and more efficient, you're making theft and murder and violence more efficient. Like, you're not fixing the underlying problem. It's this whole theory that I've been working on that statists love worrying about the fruit on the tree, and anarchists are more worried about the roots of the tree.
Yeah.
And, you can tell when someone isn't there by them wanting to attack the fruit. If you go up to a black walnut tree and you pull all the nuts off the tree and say, oh, this is going to stop this tree from killing all the other poison in the ground and killing all the other trees around it. No, the nuts are going to grow right back up. So you didn't fix anything. You temporarily put a Band-Aid on it.
Right. Right. So going back to my thesis of libertarian political activism as Keynesian in nature, what you are doing is you are putting off the inevitable collapse. Now, us as no government folks, libertarians, anarchists, abolitionists, voluntarists, whatever, leave me alone, or leave me the hell alone, Rand.
We need to make a LBGT, but it's you know, like voluntarist.
An acronym.
Yeah.
Yeah. So anyway, you know, with us, the state in its entirety is intolerable. Okay, mm-hmm. We don't want to make it better. We don't want to make it more palatable. We want this bubble to pop and go away.
Yeah.
Now, if you take the, you know, if you rotate the boot to where the ball of the foot is on somebody's neck instead of the heel, they might think that it's a little bit better. You know, people will go on a nut over 35% tax rates for income tax. Mm-hmm. But there's a lot of people out there that go saying, well, if 10% is good enough for Jesus, I'll be good enough for Uncle Sam. If you get it down to 10%, there are a lot of people that are going to say, oh my God, this is the best thing since sliced bread. And incidentally, at one time, the government did ban sliced bread because that's what they do, is they ban shit. But if income tax got down to 10%, you know, somebody who's been paying 30%, do you think that they would want to abolish all government if it got down to 10%? Or do you think they would be so euphoric from going from 20 to 30% down to 10%?
Well, I sure makes... would be happy going to 10%. but it wouldn't change my want for the state to disappear.
Yeah, but I see what you're saying, though. For a statist who goes down that far, they could easily get stuck there, and then you'd have to start, basically, if you were, you know, assuming you were working on them one-on-one to bring them down to anarchism, well, now you've reached that 10% level, and now you have to start all over again, because they're going to be like, no, this is great. Yeah. It's not so much better now.
Men only believe what they can see. They only believe what they can see. So, you know, that's why I like Thoreau so much. He's like, if you want to show a man something in this world, don't talk about it. Don't write about it. Show them. Be the example. You know, government is losing so badly at this point. You know, they're falling apart. I've never seen people as radicalized as they are in my entire life as I have now.
Well, here's one for you. I have a number of friends that are like the conservative, maybe even neocon, but, you know, the black conservatives are the worst. They are just seriously, you know, support the police, you know, all this other stuff, and, you know, Trump lovers and everything else. I can't say all of them, but it seems like a lot of them are, you know, obey the law, which means obey government. But, I put out a post the other day, things that I don't hear too much anymore. Hey, it's still a free country. things that I hear a lot more of. Better no government at all than the government that exists today.
Mm-hmm.
Now, let's go back to the it's a free country. How often do you hear that anymore?
Only in jest and conjecture.
Yeah. In our circle, yeah, exactly. In our circles, when we're mocking other people.
Because I don't know how old you guys are. I'll be 45 this year.
I'm right behind you. I'm almost 40.
Okay. All right. Well,
I'm the young in here. I'm 28.
Yeah. Well, I'm actually 29 in worm years. But
okay.
I mean, back growing up, you would hear people say, "Hey, it's a free country, right?"
Absolutely. You know?
And it wasn't met with the dripping with the sarcasm that it is today. and when I was growing up, I mean, the thought of anarchy, you know, there was just absolutely nothing to, you know, make the idea even palatable. And although probably 90 to 95% of the world is status in one form or another, you know, going from like mini status all the way up to, you know, hardcore bootlicking Tory statist, or
King.
Full-blown communist statist, there's a lot of people that are losing faith. The curtain is being pulled back, and people are seeing, you know, that it's just a little flaccid man back there. That the state is not this great god. It's not the Wizard of Oz that they've been taught to believe that it is. Mm-hmm. And the faith is actually dissipating quite a bit. So here's the question: if our goal is to end this religious faith in the state, and the state with a capital S is the religion that legitimizes the existence of governments and states, meaning separate states, nation states. If our goal is to end the state in its entirety so that humanity can survive and not lose another quarter billion people outside of war like it did last century, why would we do anything to keep that filthy monster beast from committing suicide?
I have a really good analogy. It's like government is this balloon, right? And, you know, anarchists just want to pop that balloon with a big needle. Libertarian party people, they want to, like, go untie the knot and slowly, slowly let some air out.
Yeah.
It's not going to work. Like, it's going to – if it did, it's going to reinflate.
Yes. If you look at history, there have been certain times where maybe some gains in liberty were had. Ultimately, at the end of the year, it was still a loss. But I mean, there were some pretty decent gains. You can point to things and say, okay, this is better. Mm-hmm. Coolidge is normally considered to be, you know, the Harding Coolidge years are considered to be like that. And yeah. It's kind of bullshit because I believe it was Coolidge that signed the bill that nationalized the roads.
Yeah, they did.
I also believe there was a major gun control act passed under him. And, what was it? Oh, yeah, the charter for the Fed was made indefinite under him, too. But anyway, so, yeah, silent do-nothing Cal.
Yeah.
But, okay, let's say that it was actually gains in liberty. But right after that, you had Hoover,
mm-hmm.
and then FDR a few times, and then Truman, and so on and so on. So the best that you can hope for is a brief respite from the growth in tyranny,
mm-hmm.
or for the tyranny to grow a little bit slower. So when you make one particular thing a little bit better, you know, that prolongs the life of the state, and, you know, that's a big mess with it. So libertarian activism is actually like a Keynesian stimulus program for government.
Yeah. I mean, what was it someone was saying? Oh, yeah, Bill Bupert was saying on y'all's show the other day, you know, like the sovereign citizens are like the most deluded statist of all.
Oh, yeah, they're idiots. Thinking that they're going to use some magic words? They'd be better off trying the Jedi mind trick.
Or a fully loaded AR-15.
Well, I do have some friends in those type of communities, and my beef with them, I mean, I actually, before I decided to give up altogether and admit to myself that I was an anarchist, I actually tried out some of their, you know, some of their so-called reasoning. But my bigger issue with them is not just that they think some piece of, you know, some magic words are going to get them what they want. It's what they want that is actually even worse, because they really think that going back to the Constitution as written, as supposedly, you know, intended, will save them and will save everybody and will actually give them freedom. And, you know, you touched on that earlier. They don't even recognize that it's the Constitution that actually created all these things. I mean, when I found No Treason by Spooner, like, that blew my mind, and that sunk any hope I ever had of believing in the Constitution whatsoever, because it really was. And then when you look at it, you know, Article 1, Section 8 creates and codifies the ruling class by stating Congress shall have the power to. Who the fuck gave him that power?
Hey, do you have the magic parchment up on your computer right now?
I do not. I try to keep it as far away from me as
possible. I can pull it up real quick.
All right, pull it up. Dave. please.
What do you want me to look up?
Article 1, Section 9. And while you're doing that, hey, Jeremy, what do you think of the indefinite detention provision of NDA 2012? You think it's a good thing?
Oh, of course not. Well,
okay.
No. Which clause?
2.
Clause 2. The privilege of writ of habeas corpus shall not be suspended unless when in case of rebellion or invasion,
of course,
the public safety may require it. I mean, I knew exactly what that was. I just wanted to read it for people.
The privilege of the writ of habeas corpus. Not the right, the privilege.
Mm-hmm.
So,
well, yeah, and then you have lawyers. You have all these founding fathers also said that, you know, the government probably should be overthrown and rebuilt every generation or so.
Well, no, Jefferson said that, and that's because he actually had nothing to do with writing the Constitution. He was in France during the whole process.
Right.
Well, you have all these, it's individual liberties and et cetera, and all this, and, you know, you should be able to secede from the Union. That was preached a lot, and it's like, well, if you try to secede, that's an act of rebellion, and we're going to suspend all your writ of, I mean, it happened during the Civil War.
It happened during the War of 1812.
Yep.
A lot of the New England states were threatening to secede over Madison's little adventurism.
Yeah, they didn't want to give up their militias. They were refusing, right?
Yeah. And incidentally, the U.S. the U.S. or America is 0-2 for invading Canada.
and the Canadians get mocked all the time. It's such a shame.
Yeah.
Well, Canada cannot have an army now because they have if you either have socialist healthcare or an army, you can't really have both. I don't know if you've seen that trend in the world. China does it, but I mean, I don't know how they fund. I mean, their economy is so much of a big lie.
And their successes are from going from state socialism to fascism.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, but anyway,
big improvement.
Yeah, so, well, for them it is. But just like getting down to 10%, it's a big improvement, but it shouldn't be a freaking goal.
Yeah.
You know? And with the Constitution lickers, you know, they'll use the thing of, well, wouldn't it be better to get whipped 10 times a day by the slave master than 20? Well, yeah, but why aren't you putting running away from the plantation on the menu? Why is 10 lashes your end goal?
It's the religious attachment that people have to the flag, the nation, the Constitution.
Well, it's the incrementalism. I mean, I honestly, I mean, because we did have this discussion when Luis was on when we discussed using the Libertarian Party, and I can see some of their arguments, and I could get it because, you know, I guess I still have a soft spot for them because before I finally made the plunge into anarchism all the way, I actually ran on the Libertarian ticket for local office around here, so I know a bunch of the people in the party, you know, like, and I don't know. I could see their point in some of it, but for the most part, yeah. If you want it gone, let's just focus on getting rid of it. Because the incrementalism, you're right. It's eventually enough people are going to go, oh, but we still need this, and and then it just starts to climb right back in again. And that is the trend throughout history, not just here but everywhere. No government has ever shrank once it started growing. It just never happens.
Yeah.
Even if for the brief respite, it ends up being, you know, it's just how much tyranny do you finally end up with before there's a revolt? That's the only difference.
It might start at size 5, go up to size 10. It will never get back to size 5 again. Mm-hmm. Probably the best that you can hope for is size 7.
Exactly.
Okay. Well, I'm hoping that I got the libertarian political activism as Keynesian in nature point across. It's not something that I put a whole lot of thought into yet, and it just literally popped in my head fairly recently. But when you look at political activity, it's like the stimulus projects. There's only so many things that you can do to stimulate an economy, and it comes down to politicians giving money to businesses that are failing in an effort to keep them from failing. Now, if you have a truly free market, the only way that a business is failing is if they are not satisfying consumer demand, or if the consumer does not want what they have to sell. and in which case they should fail. I mean, it's like a restaurant that screws up every dinner, and there's absolutely no reason that it should be helped to stay in business if they're burning the food and the
service
sucks.
Isn't that what government is?
Yeah. So when
government's a restaurant that burns every dinner.
Yeah. So when you're trying to get rid of government, so if you're an anarchist, voluntarist, whatever, getting involved in politics, you're keeping the restaurant that screws everything up open even longer. Because, as we talked about before, why did we get to the point that, or how did we get to the point where we are today in being no government guys? And it was because we found that it was intolerable. It can't be fixed because it's not really broken. I mean, government is doing what it was meant to do. So, and you can't change that a whole lot. So, because there's only so many ways that you can stimulate an economy, you know, meaning redistributing wealth from people who earned it to people that are not earning it, you know, there's only so many things that you can do politically. Okay, so you're going to get your candidate in. Mm-hmm. Okay, all right. Not like that hasn't been tried or done before. Let's say Ron Paul did get elected. Okay, let's say he became the president. What about the 535 other a-holes in there?
Mm-hmm.
You know, because, you know, all legislation for taxation and spending originates in the House and all this other stuff. And, you know, Ron's not going to do everything through executive order because, you know, he's a constitutionalist. So how is all this stuff going to get taken care of? I mean, about the only thing that he can do is, as commander-in-chief, bring the troops home from the wars. That's about it.
Yeah.
So what about the 535 other clowns in there that he has to deal with? What about, you know, the 9 fruitcakes in the bathrobes? What about the heads and the employees and all these little agencies that depend upon the largesse of the police state or the military industrial complex? What about all the people that make their living supplying these people?
Mm-hmm.
What about the large amount of the population that owes its existence to the largesse of the state? So let's say Ron acted unilaterally and, you know, did an Obama with executive orders or an FDR, you know, whatever. Let's say he did this. How long do you think it would take before a crazed lone gunman got to him?
Not very long.
His presidency wouldn't last as long as Harrison's.
Probably not. And it probably wouldn't be a crazed lone gunman either. It'd probably be, you know, a bunch of crazed lone gunmen working together.
Yeah. I mean, they shot Reagan, and he wasn't even that radical. I mean, he actually grew government. They flat out killed JFK, and 2 weeks after he said he wanted to take the America back to the silver standard and get rid of the Fed. So you tell me, Rand Paul, whoever gets in there, they start trying to push libertarian agenda, they're going to get killed.
Yeah. Okay. And let's say Rand gets in there, and let's say that he's just tricking the neocons. He's not really the filthy status that he appears to be. One, he's going to get an Academy Award for his acting. But okay, let's say Audit the Fed gets passed. Mm. Do you honestly expect a truthful audit of the Fed?
Well, of course
do you expect Do you expect the Fed to turn over anything damning and shows that they're even a fraction of the evil that the average mini-status and the Fed, audit the Fed. Do you expect them to incriminate themselves in that manner?
Oh, no.
It's like
not.
The police station. We investigated ourselves and we found we did nothing wrong.
Which leads us to this.
Oh, yeah.
Who is going to do the investigation?
Government.
Yeah.
Do you think
it might be people who rely on the Fed's money creation and buying government bonds and all this other stuff for all their little pet projects? Do you think those people might wind up getting on that committee? and doing the investigation and saying, oh my God, this thing that we've been taking advantage of for all this time is absolutely horrible and out of control. It must be stopped. Oh, by the way, sorry to my constituents, you're going to have to actually earn your living now because we can't give away all this free shit. That's really going to happen?
Well, of course not. I was just going to say, you're right. Even if it was passed and they said they were going to audit it, it would be about as thorough as the last audit of Fort Knox was. What was that back in the, I think the 70s was the last one they allowed or something like that.
70s or 80s.
Yeah, and it was a photo op where they were shown like one gold bar, or they were shown a stack of gold bars, and that was it. That's all they were allowed to see. And that was even like people who were supposedly, you know, liberty minded were allowed to go on that little parade, and they still didn't get to see anything because, you know, there's a good chance it's not there. So exactly, whatever audit they would do would be covered up in so much bullshit that
they didn't cut any of those bars open to see if there's tungsten in the middle.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, have we heard about that? But anyway, so so people have this faith that, you know, hey, I know, we're gonna vote just a little bit harder. And not only are we going to vote harder, we're going to vote earlier and oftener. And we're going to get the right people in charge, and they're going to turn this thing around.
So, all right, Lou, if you're a statist and you're listening to our podcast so far, and you're at this point, what's running through your mind is, what can I do? They're either mad and say, well, Lou should just move to Somalia, or if he doesn't like it, he should just leave. Or they're at a point where, like, well, yeah, things are going to shit. It's all been terrible. What can I do? And that's the answer that they want, because, like I said earlier, people want to see it. You can't tell somebody something. They want to see it.
Well, first thing that I would say to somebody who says, you know, move away, move to Somalia, leave or whatever, why would you kick out one, the three people, meaning the three of us, the three people that don't want to bother you, the three people that want to leave you alone, that we don't want the cops to kick in your door because you have some, you know, hidden little vice. We don't care. Mm-hmm. Why, you know, why do you want to get rid of the people that, you know, don't bother you? Next up, why would you want to get rid of the people that tell you the truth, but keep the people that lie to you?
I totally believe that this society these days, people would rather be flat out lied to into oblivion. Like if NASA found out that a comet was going to directly kill everybody on Earth, everyone on Earth would rather just live oblivious than know the truth.
Yeah. And you know what? Ultimately, if they did know, what would they do? Might they, repair relationships with long-lost friends and relatives? You know, go to the grave knowing that, you know, they buried the hatchet in some regards? Or that they got to spend that last vacation doing something? Or spend that special time with somebody? You know, because they know that their time is limited?
Do a bunch of cocaine. We gotcha.
Yeah, or do a bunch of cocaine, you know, whatever. But, you know, so do you want the uncomfortable truth or the comfortable lie, which is going to serve you better?
Well, the comfortable lie is what statism is built on.
Yes, yes, and it does come down to a faith in the state. So, when people always say, well, what's the anarchist solution to this? What's the anarchist solution to that? You know, let's take, what about the poor? Okay. Well, you want to know what we would do? We would do the same thing that government did to help the poor and solve that problem. Oh, wait, that problem still exists? So I guess government isn't really such a solution. And I get this all the time from left and right wingers. Right wingers generally couldn't give a shit about the poor under any circumstances, unless unless you're advocating privatizing security, getting rid of government police and law enforcement, replacing with private security and protection. The first thing they're going to say is, what about the poor? Okay, well, how do the poor have it now? You know, how do the poor in Baltimore, Ferguson, Chicago, Detroit, all these places, tell me how great things are under government policing for them right now.
There's one word to describe it. It's shitty.
Yeah. So
utter failure.
But also when you look at the market, and granted, we don't know what a truly free market would look like because we don't have it. And contrary to what Romney says, you know, when he's saying you can't have a free market without regulation, you know, what part of free don't you understand? There's no such thing as half free, sort of free, kind of free, or even free-ish. You're either free or you are not free. Mm-hmm. And when, you know,
you can't have a little pee in your pool.
yeah. And the amount of government intervention into the economy is the amount of state socialism you think is acceptable. How much socialism do you think is acceptable, Mr. Conservative?
Yeah.
So, I mean, and generally I try not to go at them that rough because I need to have to come from a place of love. And No, seriously, you know you do. The number of people that have changed their mind because somebody said, hey, you're an idiot, you need to agree with me, and they said, oh, gee, you're right, I am an idiot, now I am going to agree with you. The number of people that have changed their minds off after being called an idiot is probably somewhere, I don't know, south of zero. But anyway.
Most military guys that are on our side now, they needed it beaten over their head.
Well, you can gently beat them over the head with it in many cases. But here's the thing. It's, you know, rather than me having to justify anarchism or statelessness or non-government being involved in everything, maybe they should explain and justify having the government involved. And they should also, you know, explain why they're constantly bitching about the government. And they say government needs to get out of it, but they never say completely out of it or government needs to go away entirely. And it's ultimately getting at that religious faith, the state. Now, I'm going to give you an example. A conservative Facebook friend of mine shared this, and he says, an interesting question by Lou. So the same government that can't keep drugs and weapons out of their own prisons is going to keep illegal immigrants out of the country. How is this going to happen? With guards and fences, with barbed wire? Republican delusions have surpassed Democrat levels. Statism, it's a hell of a drug. So, I mean, let's think about this. Other than a mass grave, what is more government than a prison?
Not much.
Or a school.
Yeah, well, but you repeat yourself.
Yeah, yeah. Well,
a school is just a mass grave for critical thought. And
yeah.
If you think about it.
Yeah, the funding for schools is one-third of what it is for prisons. But, you know, the kids spend one-third of the time incarcerated. So it comes out in the wash. Yeah. But let's think about this. So in just going with the immigration, because with Trump going, you know, being loud and obnoxious, and he's actually a blowhard. Exactly is the government that, incidentally, you know, the conservatives say can't run the post office, how are they going to keep immigrants out when they can't keep?
It's just contradictions. It's right. It's ridiculous.
Right. Now, of course, they're going to say, well, you know, the guards are being bribed at the prison, or the guards are bringing them in. Oh, okay. So what's going to keep the guards from letting immigrants through, you know, through the fence, mm-hmm. or smuggling them in themselves? How do you think so many consumer goods were smuggled into Russia during the Soviet days?
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Yeah.
Went through the border guards. And because the border guards had a 50-50 shot of being arrested for being involved in smuggling, whether they were guilty or not, they may as well have gotten involved in it.
Yeah,
Because they're just going to go grab up a bunch of people and say, hey, you know, boom, you're busted. You mm-hmm. know, you know, but I wasn't one of them. Ah, too bad. This is Soviet Union.
Yeah, well, I think it's because it's the right we're talking about with this religious nature. I guess they most of them assume some kind of angels are going to come down from up above, and they're going to be the ones who are going to be the guards.
Now let's take it a step further. Okay, we know that people and drugs and all sort of stuff are being smuggled in on container ships. So are they going to check every single container? Not only are you controlling the southern border, you also have to control the coastlines.
Mm-hmm.
And Alaska and Hawaii.
Yeah.
And Guam and Puerto Rico.
Yeah. So how much is this going to cost to provide this proper security?
A bankruptcy level amount of money.
Yeah. And plus, we still have no guarantee that it's going to work.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, it's a completely fascistic idea.
Yeah. Now, next up, how many, I think I asked you this before we got started. Name the countries that have had strong border security, immigration laws, checkpoints, and stuff like that.
North Korea comes to mind.
Yeah.
Totalitarian fascist states, Russia, Ukraine, Georgia, Eastern Bloc, Europe.
The whole Soviet Union, East Germany.
Switzerland.
All the best places in the world.
Switzerland.
Saudi Arabia has a really good one.
Switzerland never had really bad border security.
They're pretty...
Western Europe has been pretty lax for the most part.
Yeah, no, it's all the big boogeyman from the past, or some from the present, that the very same people that are clamoring for, are taught to fear and taught to like they're these horrible people. Well, you want the same thing, and they don't even realize that that's what they're asking for.
Mm-hmm. So,
we're gonna do fascism right. They did it wrong.
Yeah. Now, I mean, the common conservative Tory bootlicker excuse that I'll usually get is, well, that was to keep their people in. Okay, yeah, it was. Now, how many of those would-be tyrants, how many Stalins, Maos, Pol Pots, Hitlers, Lenins, all those other guys, how many of them said, you know what, these border guards are to keep you in? How many of them were honest and said, you know, this is to keep you in and make sure that you submit? No.
Well, every last country. No. Like, that's a plank of the Communist Manifesto, is to basically stop all immigration with an E, and to steal anybody that tries to immigrate from the communist nation's property.
Yeah, but okay, the Communist Manifesto says that, but how many of these politicians said, no, this is to keep you in because you are prisoners. You are tax cattle on our tax farm.
Well, why would you want to leave the workers' paradise?
Well, of course. They sold it as keeping the evil outsiders out. That's how it's sold.
To keep the decadent West.
What does the conservative think? They're going to roll to the border with Mexico, and on one side the line's going to be 10,000 cars deep, and on the American side going into Mexico it's just like, oh, you're American? Come on through. No checks, no nothing. We'll get you on your way back in. Mm-hmm. It's not. No, you're going to be checked going out. You're going to be checked going in.
And that's if you're allowed to go out. Seriously, if they put turrets and watchtowers along the border, what's to keep them from turning those rifles inward?
Exactly.
Oh, that can't happen here. Or as they said, in Germany back in the 30s, hier kann das nicht passieren.
Yeah, that's the refrain. It's always bad somewhere else. It'll never be like that here, but because they don't see everything that already has happened here and continues to happen, and it's pretty much always happened.
So, ultimately, when the conservatives trade liberty for security and get neither, how much is this going to cost, and how is it going to be paid for? Because the U.S. is already spending deficits each year, the U.S. government. They're already losing money. So what are the conservatives going to cut? And how much are they going to have to cut to be able to pay for this? How much are they going to have to borrow on the backs of the unborn?
Yeah.
No, you definitely hit it right on the nail.
So, let me drive the nail into the coffin just a little bit more. What I would ask these small government conservatives is just exactly how much more they are willing to grow the living fucking shit out of government by spending more money than has ever been spent before, by increasing the power of the state, the enforcement wing of the state, by taking away people's freedom, not just foreign people's freedom, but domestic people's freedom, and, how far are they willing to go to reach their total socialist fascist paradise? And I got to tell you what, with the love of nationalism, militarism, border security, and many of the economic controls that are in place, because conservatives do not want a truly free market. They want a fascist
protectionist
market. Yeah, mm-hmm. They want a fascist controlled protectionist market. So honestly, when we look at things like that, what is the difference between the American conservative and the Soviet communist hardliner?
Very few things as far as rhetoric and jingoism goes.
Perception. That's really all it is.
They're not wearing the red coat or whatever, yeah. the brown coat.
They see themselves as completely different because they don't think about these things. It's funny, you ask, how are they going to afford all this? When I ask questions like that, the most common answer I get from some of these folks is they honestly believe, they just have to enforce, you know, because most of them are still so hardcore anti-Obama because they really think he's the devil and everything happened with him that, you know, if the laws were there now were just enforced, we'd be so much better off. It's like, no, you're still limiting freedom. You're still messing with people and you're still turning human beings into illegal people, which is just not possible. A human being cannot be illegal. You know, I tell them all the time. It pisses them off. Migration's not a crime. I don't care what your government tells you.
I mean, have you heard the theory that tomorrow's liberals are today's conservatives?
I think I've heard the other way around.
Yeah, I was gonna say because that the other way around falls in line with the If you're under 30 and you're conservative, you have no heart, or if you're over 30 and a liberal, you have no brain.
Yeah, tomorrow's liberals are today's conservatives.
No, the other way around.
That's the other way around.
Today's liberals are tomorrow's conservative, because when you before 30, you're a liberal because you're
more about
the
like,
feels.
Like the, all the people that are in politics now, they grew up in like the 70s, right? 60s, 70s. Like they, as far as wrapping their ideas around political thought.
Well, most of the politicians are so wishy-washy. They change with the wind.
Oh no, right? Yeah, it's with whoever's giving them the most money.
The Clintons were hippies in the '60s.
Well, yeah, money changes everything.
They didn't sell out; they bought in.
Oh, absolutely! Hell yeah!
I'm just saying.
They went from supposed peaceniks to Hillary's one of the biggest war hawks the world's ever seen. She wants to nuke everything in sight.
Well,
What that really shows is that, you know, even the most devoted to their ideology can't put on the ring of power without changing, without turning into Smeagol.
Absolutely. You can't.
That's
why when people talk about the conspiracy theories about what may possibly happen when somebody becomes president, you know, the stories about, you know, the little room they pull them into and show them this stuff. It's like, whether that stuff is true or not, it has to be, because you're given this power over people and that can't not change you. when you're given a free pass to like rule over people, well, yeah, you're going to take advantage of it.
Yeah.
That's why I want no part of it.
Yeah. So, all right, we've done an awful lot of bitching so far. So let's touch on some solutions here. I think one of the best things that can be done, because once you realize that the state is a losing proposition and that it's a destructive monster, and as Bob Higgs named one of his speeches, the state is too dangerous to tolerate.
Yep. That was a good one.
So how do humans get past that? Well, one, by not being adherents to the religion of the state, and that's a good start. And yeah, it's nice if you can get other people to see, but ultimately the state itself has to get so bad that people recognize there's a problem before they're even willing to consider a solution. And that's why Ron Paul was ignored for all those years. Mm-hmm. The perception was that there was still liberty. The perception was that the tyranny was not bad enough to go into rehab. Now, yeah. Instead of stimulating the tyranny and prolonging the life of it, walk away. I personally think that we're going to see a lot of people going galt. There's going to be people that expatriate. Some are going to do it, you know, on the books. Some of them are just going to buy a one-way ticket to somewhere else, take their mm-hmm. money, and not come back. Or there's going to be people that are going to do the underground economy. And people better hope so, because once Obamacare kicks in and gets going into full, you know, socialistic mode,
mm-hmm.
you know, these conservatives are opposed to smuggling and stuff like that, they're gonna want the smugglers to bring their medications in.
Absolutely.
I'm not talking about, you know, chemotherapy drugs. I'm talking about, you know, basic drugs. In the Soviet Union, you couldn't get drugs at the pharmacy. You had to go to the black market. The people in the hospitals would even tell you that. Had it not been for the black market, the Soviet Union would have collapsed long before. Hell, in the 80s, the government of the Soviet Union even admitted that at least 20% of their economy was the black market. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was verified. The World Bank today shows that at least 20% of the world economy is the black market. And when you see what's going on in Greece, Greece is a canary in the coal mine. Now, when's it going to happen here? I don't know.
That was the name of our last episode.
Canary in the coal mine?
Yeah.
Greece, the canary in the coal mine.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
You know, as I was going through your YouTube page, maybe I saw it and it subliminally messaged itself into
my
brain.
Well, I'm all about subliminal messaging and endless repetition training.
So. Okay. So, well, anyway.
You know. That's why I say fascism about 4 or 5 times an episode.
Yeah.
Maybe 10.
So Greece and some of the other European states are in the same boat. So, you know, what is the solution? Get involved politically and prolong the life of it, or get past it?
Mm-hmm.
So, I think there's going to be a lot of off-the-books businesses. If somebody doesn't go full agorist, they're definitely going to go partially agorist. Because when it comes to employment, the number of full-time jobs out there is dwindling. Obamacare puts full-time employment at 29 hours or above. And for some crazy reason, I don't know why, you know, doing the Forrest Gump thing, nobody seems to want to hire anybody for more than 28 hours.
Yeah, right?
Yeah, my buddy just got a job. He works 28 hours and 50 minutes a week.
Yeah. Absolutely.
And if he goes over the 29 hours, he'll probably get fired.
Yeah.
No overtime. He's got to get going.
Yeah. If for some reason he doesn't punch out in time and he has 29 hours, they probably freak out.
Oh, I think
it's an average thing
they'll cook their own books.
Yeah. They'll,
well, yeah, yeah. But if you ask the leftists about that, they have no idea what you're talking about, because the jobs numbers are up and the employment numbers are down, and, you know, because they only think in things of the aggregate. They don't bother to pay attention to the little details that, oh, yeah, there's jobs. They're all part-time.
Well, you know what? According to the formula for government statistics, I'm actually 6'2", 187 pounds, 28-inch waist. My hairline is where it started. My hairline's in the same place as it was when I was 20.
Yeah. You know? Of course. Well, I agree with you, because I opting out is what I encourage everybody to do. I actually just I do a little rant for our channel too, and I just did one the other day on this about just opting out of the system and finding ways to disassociate yourself from it, and whether it is to spend the money and expatriate, quote unquote, properly, or whether you just buy yourself a ticket, or whether you are like me and just stay here and just keep opting out in as many ways as possible. You know, I started taking my business the agorist route as of the first of this year.
There is a way to do renounce your citizenship for free. You have to go to another country. See, the UN made it illegal for you to not be a citizen of a nation, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you go to another nation, you go into the U.S. embassy, and you announce to the clerk or whoever is there registering, I officially renounce my United States citizenship. You sign a paper, you're out there. Costs no money.
It's not even about the money for me. I don't care about that. To me, that's another thing that gives the system legitimacy. I have to let you know that I'm no longer a citizen? No. I've declared myself I'm not a citizen of your little game anymore. So there you go. Mm-hmm.
but here's the thing. If you look at the number of people, and even conservatives, yeah, and conservatives are horrible cop apologists, but they're waking up to the police state. They're waking up to the police brutality, the violence, the killings, the shakedowns, the civil asset forfeiture.
Yeah.
You know,
God,
and,
yeah.
And when you have conservatives complaining about this, when you have conservatives that have been drug warriors all their lives, and now they're saying, you know what, maybe the drug war isn't such a good thing.
My parents, both right-wing conservative Christians, the other day said, yeah, I think it might be time to end the drug war. It's not working.
Yeah. I'm like,
repeat that one more time so I can hear that.
I recently had a conversation with a state trooper. In my line of work, I unfortunately have to deal with cops once a month. And he was talking about, the heroin problem. I says, well, are you guys still enforcing the cannabis laws and you know, making the world a worse place? And he says, well, yeah, they're still on the books. So, yeah, I have to. And I says, my response, you'll love it. I says, well, I guess it's a good thing that the segregation laws aren't on the books still. I'd hate for you to have to go against your principles on that one.
Yeah.
And he just looked at me, and behind his eyes was a smoldering crater where a Hellfire missile had just landed and detonated.
Wow.
Mind blown. And he still didn't get it, I don't think.
Yeah, they never will. I had an interaction with an officer of the law a couple months ago. I think we actually talked about it on the show, and unfortunately I didn't press the slavery thing, because I was going to go with the slavery route, because it was a black cop too, and I didn't think of it at the time. But I asked him the same questions, and he gave me the same line. It's, well, it's the law, I have to. It's like, do you even hear yourself? Do you understand what you're saying? That means no matter what they put on paper, you will enforce. And you honestly think you're thinking for yourself? And they just stand there with a blank stare on their face. They either don't get it, or they do and they don't want to admit it. So their mind just shuts down.
You remember the Lemonade Freedom protests a few years back in D.C. when a bunch of Free Staters, I don't know if they were actual Free Staters from New Hampshire, but they're down in D.C.
Yeah, yeah.
And selling lemonade. And they asked this black cop, they said, hey, if the segregation laws were still on the books, would you enforce them? And he says, well, I wouldn't. If the segregation laws were still on the books, I wouldn't be allowed to be a cop. And the guy says, well, if you were allowed to be a cop, would you enforce them? And he said, yes.
Whoa.
It's that whole captain going down with the ship thing.
Let's go a little bit further. What exactly is the law?
Opinion with a gun.
Yeah. Yep. You and I know this. Okay. But with the average person, whether it's the bootlicker Tory conservative.
I mean, it just starts with a bill on Capitol Hill, you know?
you've probably seen the pictures of Moses coming down from the mountain with the tablets, mm-hmm. the Ten Commandments and everything. People think that that's where the law comes from. But where the law really comes from is John Boehner, Nancy Pelosi.
And his donors and her donors.
Yeah, Mitch McConnell, Harry Reid, you know, conservatives, those guys that you really hate.
Mm-hmm.
So when somebody says obey the law, you know, you're actually saying obey the government, obey the politicians that we call idiots all day and all night. You need to obey the guys that we're trying to vote out, because they make the law. They're idiots, but you better obey them. We want them gone, but you better obey them.
Well, of course. These are some of the same people that will tell you in one breath that they physically hate Obama, and then in the other breath will still say, but I still have to respect the office.
You have to respect the office of somebody that would abuse you, that would force you to sign up for a program that you don't like, that would prohibit you from doing things that you want to do that don't harm other people. You have to respect the office of the person that does that? Really?
It's Stockholm syndrome at its finest.
Yes, it's government belief is Stockholm syndrome.
Yeah, I'm not a big fan of Hitler, but you do have to respect the office of chancellor.
Exactly.
And for you conservatives out there, for you anti-government conservatives out there, do you have to respect the office of the president of the Rotary Club, the local fly fishing club? Do you have to respect the office of the president of a bank or the president of a corporation? Or is it just the government worship to where you have to respect the office of the president because he is the government?
Yeah. Lou, you sound like a prime candidate of someone who needs to move to Somalia.
Well, they don't, well, yeah, but that's, of course.
That's all they're going to say. Like, they're not going to think this stuff through.
Well, yeah, because it's asking them to use logic consistently. And if they could do that, they wouldn't be statist anymore. They'd be on our side of the fence.
Well, that's what it usually takes. I
also
like to throw a little bit of humor in there, and that usually lightens the mood. But, you know, if I can't get the humor in, it's a, Is there a particular reason why you can't answer this? Is there a particular reason why you were unwilling to answer this? Because if there is, let me tell you, I think I know what it is. I used to be you. Mm-hmm. I used to say the same things that you say. And what helped me to get over that was my desire to be honest and consistent was greater than my desire to spout lies and be inconsistent.
Exactly.
You nailed it, man. That's what I tell whenever I'm arguing with a conservative. I say, look, man, I know every argument that you have right now. I know every one of them. I can articulate your argument better than you can because I know more about this stuff than you. Mm-hmm. All you're giving me is jingos and rhetoric and indoctrination. I want you to think. It like you said earlier, it comes from a place of love. It's like, I don't want you to walk around blind and dumb your whole life. I want you to know these things.
What's that thing that Larkin Rose keeps saying? I keep telling people they ought to be free, and they keep shouting, no, I shouldn't.
most common answer, no, I shouldn't. Yeah, of course. You know? Yep. And that's even worse if they admit even if you want to admit that you shouldn't be free, they extend it past that because they don't want that for themselves. That means nobody else should have it because they expect everybody else to live within their imagination, not their own.
Within the limits of their imagination.
You're right.
Yeah. So, but what it really shows, and this is something that CJ was talking about in a show not too long ago. I think it was either the Whiskey Rebellion or Shays Rebellion, but it is people that have a greater love and affinity for obedience, submission, and following the declarations of government than they have of a love of freedom.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's been beaten into their brains for generations.
Well, they think they are free. That's why they don't have to want actual freedom because they've been convinced that it already exists, or the freedom that they're allowed now is all that they can be allowed because, you know, the bad people will come otherwise.
Of course. I'm free. I've got all the license and permits to prove it.
Yeah. One of the guys that was working on a job site with me, he lives in Colorado, and he was talking. We actually had a lot of. He was like really questioning, like never confronty. And I was like, "Do you actually think you're free?" He's like, "Yeah, man, I'm pretty free. I can do whatever I want on my property." I said, "Really? Have you thought about maybe opening up a large compound to make methamphetamine on that property?" And he was like, "I said, did you just get it? did it hit home on that one? Because if you can't do what you want on your own property, then you don't have the highest claim to that property. Someone else does, mainly the government. If the government has the highest claim on your property, you don't own it.
If you don't own your property, you're not free."
Well, with you being down south, Dave, this might not apply to you, but for me and Jeremy, If you own your property, if you're free on your property, can you raise chickens in your backyard?
In Alabama, you can.
No, yeah, they. It's funny. I actually was looking into that. In my area, for some reason, I think we're still allowed. I think we're allowed to have two, if we get our neighbor's permission.
Yeah, my
we can have two.
My girlfriend's.
But most places, no. You're right. You can't. You know, there's places down south. There's other places you can't. You're not allowed to collect rainwater on your own property.
How tall of a fence are you allowed to make?
Oh, only 6 feet.
Oh, yeah, I can't have a fence in my front yard over here in my neighborhood.
Yeah.
I could build one 20 foot high in my backyard, but I'm free,
yeah. I tell you.
But that's more of the city ordinance. But yeah, you're still right. I mean, there would be city ordinances government. And stuff.
Yeah, but here's the thing. I mean, everybody focuses on Obama and all those other guys.
Well, he's an evil socialist Muslim with stinky feet.
Yeah, he's a liar, a socialist, and his feet stink. But here's the thing. The average person, the the most tyranny that they deal with on a daily basis is local tyranny. Mm-hmm. That's not FBI agents sitting down at your street corner making sure that you stop and wait 3 seconds at the stop sign. And here in Michigan, there's nothing in the book about waiting 3 seconds. So, yep. You know, it's not FBI agents that are on the side of the road with their radar cameras. It's not FBI agents that are going around your neighborhood looking for code violations. It's not the FBI agents that they're really doing most of the shit that you have to put up with. It's local, county, state ordinances and laws, things like that. I mean, ultimately, the government gun that people are exposed to the least is the federal government.
Yeah.
That's why it's so hard for a lot of people to see how bad it is. Exactly, you're right, because they don't. Oh, the government doesn't bother me. What could be wrong with the government?
Well, you know the thing in California where they just stopped prosecuting anybody for drugs as long as it wasn't like mass quantities we were selling. Like, obviously, if they rolled into like a 10,000 square foot mansion and you've got a meth lab in there or a cocaine factory, they're gonna shut you down. But like Joe that's got a 8-ball of cocaine on him, they're not gonna send you to jail for it. That came out because there was a few counties in a few cities in California that were the citizens petitioned the mayor to tell the cops to stop enforcing those laws because they are federal laws, not local laws. And basically, it was like, hey, if the DEA and the feds want to come down here and enforce these laws, by all means, but we're not doing it. So that was the sentiment, and that's why it's like state law now.
Hmm. Laws are laws. Still opinions. Still somebody's gun.
That still goes back to the Keynesianism thing.
Yeah. So here's the thing. As you were hammering down the nail in one particular law, one bad law, how many other bad laws are still popping up? So when it comes to incremental reduction of government, and Judge Knapp has talked about this. I love Judge Knapp. He's a powerful speaker. He's a very brilliant guy. But when he talks about incremental reduction of the state down to nothing, well, Christ, they can't even get an actual spending cut. The best that they can hope for is a 5% reduction in the increase or the automatic increase of what it would be.
Mm-hmm.
So instead of increasing it a certain amount, they're going to take a couple pennies off of how much they were going to increase it, and they call that a spending cut.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, really?
Yeah, the government cut $5 billion off. Oh, okay, well, that was gone in 3 days.
No, they didn't cut it, but that's what Lou was saying. They didn't actually cut it.
No, exactly.
They raised it $10 billion first, and then they cut the $5 billion. Yeah, look. Yeah.
It's called a Shanghai.
Yeah, it's like the mattress store. I mean, is there ever a day where mattresses are not on sale at a store? It doesn't matter what furniture store it is. There's always a sale.
Yeah.
So they go in there and they, they mark up the price of this is what it is. And now we're going to have our, 4th of July sale, our Columbus Day sale, our Christmas in August sale, whatever it is. And they're always on sale. So how much is the real price? Well, it's the sale price.
Yep.
But, people have this idea, oh, my God, I'm saving all this money because, they knock 40% off of the price. Or they'll say, hey, we're cutting the budget because, they're not going to raise the budget as much as they were going to. So, it's...
I could either hit you in the head 10 times with my baton or 5.
My goal is to only be hit 5 times.
Yes.
Not 0. Well, just, not six, just, not just, even four.
Five for now.
Yeah.
Maybe we'll get to that zero thing later. But
so
No. We can never get to zero. I mean, that would just be too radical. As a matter of fact, we should be measured in it. Instead of going from 10 to 5, why don't we go from 10 to 9, stay there for a year or two, then go down to 8 per day, stay there for a year or two, and if I'm still alive in like 20 years, you can get it down to 5. Because we have to do incremental reduction.
You can't pull the carpet up from under the feet. You can't pull the rug out from under the feet of all these poor people, Lou. Come on.
What do you think's going to happen when the bubble pops?
It's going to be mayhem. There are going to be riots in the street. It's going to look like goddamn Venezuela out there.
So where's the rug going to be when that happens?
In shambles, torn apart, on fire.
Yeah, but that can't happen here, you know? So, of course,
you're kind of sneak pissing.
they don't think it because they're still stuck in that mindset that certain things just can't happen here, so it won't. You know, the whole idea of the system finally collapsing because the dollar finally crashes altogether. Oh, that can't happen. You know, those crazy people like Ron Paul and Peter Schiff and all them have been warning about it for years, and it hasn't happened yet. So it's not going to happen. Like, that's the mindset. It hasn't happened yet, so it's not going to happen at all. Well, just look around the world. Look at history. It happens every time. It has to.
It happens everywhere.
And yeah. What's scary is as every government goes down, it gets more violently in almost every case. It gets more tighter on its controls and more violent.
Well, it has to, because people finally start rejecting it, and that's when things start going down. But so, they also... Oh, go ahead, Luke.
So here's the part that you're not going to like. And if it does happen like that, I see the collapse of America happening in a couple different ways. One, I see it being a major war, and no, there's not going to be foreign invaders coming in and, you know, taking the beaches of San Diego and all sort of crap. It's not going to happen like that, but it might be missile strikes, whether it's nuclear or non-nuclear, don't know. It might be bombing runs, stuff like that. It might be some actual ground attacks, but it is literally impossible to invade and occupy the entire U.S. or even a significant portion of it. So that's not going to happen. But, you know, is there going to be, you know, major war? And let's remember that the weapons of today make the weapons of World War II look like slingshots, bows and arrows, stuff like that. Or it might just be the economic collapse where the currency gets, you know, blown out of proportion. And, you know, just everything just turns into a shitstorm. But I think that the crackdown to maintain control, I mean order, is going to be a type of violence that makes the Soviet gulags and the Cambodian killing fields look like a rubdown and a happy ending at the Asian massage parlor.
Yeah,
that was kind of all of my thinking on the whole conform thing I was on a rant about earlier this month. You know, conformity is kind of the thing that's beat into every statist's head. You know, that's why when we start talking, it's just they've never heard this shit before. Because there's that little paradigm that you're allowed to talk in, and when you talk outside of that paradigm, you get called a crazy, a kook, a nonconformist, essentially. So the first people that are going to go are going to be people that don't want to conform to being basically, hey, here's a shovel, dig your own grave.
Yeah. Well, one of the major problems, and you can see this in damn near any Facebook conversation or Twitter thread, whatever, or even just talking to people out on the streets, the government isn't really going to be the big problem. Your fellow citizens are. Because of the Stockholm syndrome, they are going to fight and they are going to defend the state like it is their mother. They may do it out of loyalty. They may do it out of desperation. Hey, if you turn in a family member, we'll give you a case in MREs.
Yeah. Well, they're already doing it. That's the most likely scenario because they're already doing that now. That's how the system perpetuates itself. The horizontal enforcement.
There's two things like in the Russian Revolution and the Bolshevists took over, the Communist Revolution, et cetera, et cetera. They didn't have one key ingredient that we do have now, and that's the internet. And it's very hard to lie to people now on a consistent basis and shit not get out. People now are either willing ignorance or they are dumb, blind as a bat. Mm-hmm.
You know, the internet is a beautiful thing. We probably would not know each other if not for the internet. We probably would still be, you know, bootlicking status, saying Marauds, had it not been for the internet. The internet, as far as being a device for communications and meeting people is unbelievable. I have over 2,000 Facebook friends. I have met so many of them in real life, you know, folks who live around the country. I went to Pork Fest a couple years ago, so that was an opportunity to meet a bunch of people. But, you know, for the people that are like maybe the mini statist or, you know, even, you know, like Tea Party statist, if you're interested in, you know, learning about voluntarism, you know, you probably have some friends on your Facebook friends list and, you know, Twitter feeds, whatever. Actually meet some of them. And if you want to see how it works in action, this goes back to that David Thoreau quote, you know, saying, you know, show them how to do it. You know, meet some of these people, see how they live their lives. You know, with, you know, a lot of the anarchists, I don't know too many that actually have their kids in government schools. And it's not just libertarians that are pulling their kids out of the government indoctrination camps and doing the homeschooling or the unschooling. You know, I mean, it's actual status. But the question is, why are they doing it? And it's because they don't trust the government to raise their children. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, well, being up 70%, if there's only a tiny number of people doing it before, that doesn't mean anything. Yeah.
It is.
Big thing is what percentage of the population is homeschooling or unschooling, or is just opted out of the state indoctrination system. You know, and if it's only 0.02%, there's, you know, being up 70% doesn't mean dick.
Yeah.
But, you know, I'm just being honest with you. You know, you can say it's up 70%, but you can also say that unemployment is down too, citing statistics.
Yeah, the trend is upward, but you're right. There was a very low number before that, so there's still a long way to go in that regard. But I try to preach that to everybody, but you know, you can only do what you can do. I have two little girls.
Yeah.
I'm gonna be homeschooling, unschooling them. That's my part of the puzzle. That's what I'm doing. You know.
I mean, if you look at homeschooling and unschooling and just the various little things out there, people are starting to opt out. Mm-hmm. So it is really just a matter of time before they opt out all the way. All right. You know, the 1980s and 1990s, that was snorting cocaine off a stripper's ass. All right. Now you're getting to the point to where you're shooting crocodile with a tranny hooker. All right. And it's going to be time to go to rehab.
Yep.
And people are going to start opting out of more things. And, you know, the faith in the state is going away. Now, how it winds up going after that, I don't know.
Violent communism.
Oh, yeah. Clard and Piven. And after the system collapses, you know, we must, you know, go to full socialism because Clard and Piven. Dun, 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 dun. You know, every time somebody invokes Clard and Piven, they go on a nut and...
No, but it's just you're looking at what's going on like in Greece right now, like there's like groups of anarchists over there that are just full-blown socialists, like they're not even anarchists.
Yeah.
And like the main movement in Greece is like there's the fascist on this side and then there's the hardline communist on this side, like the two forms of despotism that are the worst.
Here's something for you. I mean, one of the conservative mantras is pay down the debt. Okay, so
to who? Who owns the debt in this country? The Fed does.
Yeah. Okay, so you're gonna pay down the debt.
Doesn't want the debt paid down.
But the thing is, are they gonna pay it off completely? I mean, because what's the goal to, you know, just reduce the amount? You know, shouldn't the end goal be to pay it off completely? So, if the goal is to pay it off completely, how do you pay off over $18 trillion of current acknowledged debt? Meanwhile, having close to $1 trillion deficits each year, how does that happen?
Yeah,
it's impossible.
Math is not their strong suit, apparently.
even if they slash the size and scope of government, what would it take to pay off $18 trillion? And even if it didn't accrue interest?
Well, the problem is if you file bankruptcy...
A couple centuries.
if the government files bankruptcy or defaults on the Fed and says, hey, we can't pay the Fed, the currency gets completely fucked, and then the economy goes...
The currency's already completely
fucked. No. Yeah, but in the current paradigm, it gets worse.
If the other part of that is if you erase the debt, the currency's fucked too, because the currency goes away if you erase the debt, because it's all there because of the inflationary policies. So in order to get rid of the debt, you have to get rid of the money supply. That's what most of them don't realize. It's a debt-based system. You get rid of the debt, well, the money disappears too, and you have to start over with that again, which will be a wonderful thing for us. But
if you want to have a chuckle, ask a socialist what money is. They haven't a clue what money is.
I didn't have a clue what money was until I started on this journey a couple of years ago. I thought the piece of crap paper that's in my pocket was money.
So Lou, let's plug away and we'll close down the show. This has been a pretty long one.
Okay. All right. Yeah. Check out Campaign for a Longer Leash on Facebook. It's a fun little page. It's family friendly for 99.9% of the posts. Good, clean fun. But yeah, get out and meet people. If you're anarchist, voluntarist, abolitionist, whatever, get on out and meet people. Maybe Pork Fest is too big for you, or maybe Pork Fest is your thing. But, look for different Liberty festivals, and shameless self-promotion here. This August 7th through 10th, the Michigan Peace and Liberty Coalition is proud to present the 3rd annual Midwest Peace and Liberty Fest. It'll be held at the Circle Pine Center just outside Kalamazoo, Michigan, in the town of Delton, Michigan. And it's going to be there's a lake out there, beach, sauna house, and all sorts of activities for kids, bacon, lots of bacon, dogs welcome, longer leashes recommended. Go to miplc.org for more information to get registered. And by the way, don't quote me on this, but I believe that the adult price for the entire weekend for Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, and Monday is $55. That's your camping. Ooh. That's your admission to the event. $55. I can't even stay at home for $55 on a weekend.
Can you pay in Bitcoin?
You can pay in Bitcoin, and I am pretty sure that there is still the alternative currency discount going on.
Ooh, awesome. Look at that.
Awesome.
$55 is already a great deal. You can save even more by going agorist.
Yeah. So it's a fun camping weekend. You get a chance to meet people. I'd love to meet you guys, but you guys won't be able to make it up here, and
Yeah, this year, unfortunately, we were talking about before the show. I actually want to go to that one more than because I've never been to Pork Fest yet either. It just never works out for me. But after hearing yours being talked about, I'm like, that actually sounds like more my speed. I want to really make that one. So if anything, I'm going to do everything in my power to make sure I can find a way to do it next year, because hopefully there'll be a year 4, and then I'll haul my ass out to Michigan.
Yeah, it's smaller, it's more intimate. As a matter of fact, we do have people coming from New York State. They're from the Rochester area. We have somebody, at least one person that I know of, coming from New Hampshire, Tennessee. Last year we had somebody from as far as Georgia. We had one guy show up, I believe it was on Saturday night. He was listening to the Freedom Feens on the Chicago radio station. He was listening live on Saturday afternoon. He heard Michael and Bill Buport talking about Liberty Fest, and he got on his motorcycle, and I don't even think he put a toothbrush in his back pocket. He got on his motorcycle, rode up to Michigan, went to the fest, and hung out, I think, until Monday morning.
Wow.
That's cool.
That's awesome.
That's cool.
Before my kids came along, that's something I totally would have done. I had heard it, be like, hey, I got nothing to do. Let's go.
Yeah, so. But I don't think he loaded saddlebags or anything like that. He just got on the motorcycle and rode.
He was like, I got to see this shit.
Yeah. Hey, it's kind of like a Bob Seger song, Roll Me Away, Man. So, but it's a good time. It's an opportunity to meet other people, learn about liberty, see what it would look like. And there was just recently an article in Maxim magazine that I saw about Pork Fest, and the gal was a little bit frightened by what she saw, but she wasn't that frightened. Mm-hmm. I would have to say it was a pretty positive review. I think the indoctrination of, oh my God, guns are bad, but she went out and shot.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, most people that are anti-gun have never held a gun in their hand or shot one.
Yeah. So.
My wife was terrified of them until the first time I took her out to the range a couple of years ago, and we came back, and her first question was, when can we do that again?
Yeah. Every time you squeeze the trigger, it's like a mini orgasm, you know? It's like.
Yeah, I've taught a couple women to shoot, and they were almost better than me by the end of the first or second time. And I don't want to teach any more women to shoot. It might be too dangerous to me down the road. But I get out, meet people, learn about agorism, learn about all these things that you're gonna need to survive when the collapse happens. And even if it's not a collapse, and even if it's just a decline. You're going to need some skills.
I hope all the states break away and start getting smaller. Smaller. Like, California just did that thing, and they're talking about breaking into 9 different states. That'd be awesome. If you just continue that indefinitely.
That is incrementalism, though.
you have to continue that trend and not divert from it. And if you're familiar with Robert Higgs in his book Crisis and Leviathan, there's always a crisis to justify the increase in the size of the state. Usually it's war, but
it's almost always war.
Yeah, never let a really good crisis go to waste, because let's say you get down to maybe 100 states or something like that, and then something happens and some centralizers say, you know what, you know, there's been too much fighting between these several states here, and we need an arbitrator to be able to settle disputes between those states, and maybe we need to ensure that trade is fair. So what we're going to do is we're going to have this constitution. And we're gonna form this perpetual union of states, you know, these United States again.
Just for the really important things.
Yeah. And then the day after that it goes into effect, people are gonna start shouting, if only we could get back to the Constitution.
Absolutely. And the cycle will continue.
All right, what?
In short, I can sympathize and empathize with your thoughts on that, but I just can't agree with it, because it's a stimulus program for government. It's political.
I'm just thinking about stuff that could realistically happen and probably will happen.
Yeah, you know what? Agorism is realistic. People can start doing it. I think the
United States is going to break away into 5.
Collapse before that happens.
You have a much better chance of zero government than minimal government.
Yep.
Oh, no, I totally agree with that. But what I'm saying is I don't think the hellfire brimstone, you know, nuke or crazy wars things are. I think the government debt is going to be so inflated that you're going to have new states, just like 5 or 6 states break all our countries. Or the nation just gets cut apart, and those countries, new countries are made. I honestly think that's what's going to happen.
I can agree with you on some level, because I already started the country of abolitionia here, because I seceded from my state, so.
Abolitionia.
Well, I will be happy to be a resident of Bearscat, Kapistan.
There you go.
So, but anyway, thank you very much for the invitation to come on. I really enjoyed it. It's a nice, it's a real pleasure to finally meet you guys. It's, you know, so, yeah.
Yes. No, we really appreciate you coming on, taking the time, man. You know, for anybody out there who hasn't checked out the Freedom Feens yet, I highly suggest you do so. Catch Lou on there. That's where I first became aware of him. And if there is any way possible that you can get to his festival, the festival in Michigan in the beginning of August, do so. Because I'll be extremely jealous of you, because I'd like to be there. So I would definitely encourage people to check that out. For our content, anybody who's looking for other stuff that we do, you can find us on Stitcher, iTunes, YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, and all of that is found at theseedsofliberty.com. Dave, there's anything else you want to add, or are you good?
Check out our merch page on the website. Yeah. We just put up a few new shirts on Teespring. And also, as always, feel free to donate us. We prefer the Bitcoin variety, but, you know, it is what it is.
Just like
if you got to give us the king's money, do it.
Like and share if at all possible. That actually means more to us on the for the you know, money's nice, but getting our message out there and showing it to some news people can't hurt us either. So, all right. So thanks again to Lou for coming on. This has been the Seeds of Liberty podcast, and we will catch you next time.
Get a damn Twitter, Lou.
FreedomFiends.com, MIPLC.org. Get to Liberty Fest. It's coming up. Now get on Twitter, damn it.